change my name. I declare today's my day, and God changed my name. Today's my day. God changed my name, and I'll never be the same. God, I'll never be the same. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, God is about to do something new on today. You're here for a reason. You're here for a change. You're here for something new. You're here for what God has for you. Go with me to Luke chapter 17. Today, you're going to have to make a decision. Today, you're going to have to declare. Today, see, when we make a declaring, a decree, God stands, he's our covenantal rights with God. God stands, hallelujah, on the promises that he made, because God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. But God, what he says, he will do it. The nature of God is to bless.
Yes.
The mind of God is to bless and to create. And so God is going to do something new. So we're going to Luke chapter 17, verse. I'm going to read one verse.
Luke 17.
Luke 17, verse 4. I don't want to read that. Verse 19. Luke 17, verse 19. Y'all ready? Y'all not ready. Y'all not ready. Y'all ready for a change? Anybody praying for a change? Are you ready for a change? Luke 17 and 19. And the word of God reads, and he said to him, arise, go your way, your faith has made you well.
Amen.
You may be seated. Hallelujah. Now what I want to do is, I had to start at the end of the story. And I don't know if you're a movie watcher like me, but sometimes there are movies that start at the end of the story, and then they flash back to where it all started. But I'm not going that far back. But I like this movie. I like this change, because he said to him, he said to you, he said to me, he said to us, he said to we, today is the day that I will never be the same. Today is the day that God changed my name. Today is the day I declare it, it is so. He said, your faith, somebody say,
my faith
has made me well.
Yes.
See, the thing about this is, we're gonna be dealing with Luke 17, 11 through 19. Luke 17, 11 through 19. And there was something that was going on at this time. And Jesus was just passing through in this situation. But in the end, we win. And so that's why I had to start at the end of the story. History. At the end of the history, because everything that Jesus did happened.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
So at the end of the history, at the end of this documentary, we start back at the beginning of the story. So in Luke 17 and 11, it says, now it happened. See, change is going to come upon you so suddenly that you're going to be like, what? Did that really happen? And God is saying, now it happened. The reason why you're here on Facebook, because what? Now it happened. Yes. See, somebody said, you preaching to women? ? On my post. I posted that I was preaching today. And he said, you preaching to women? And I said, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. Amen. You don't have to scroll by my page. You don't have to come to the church. You don't have to come to God's house. But guess what? You're going to miss the happening in this place. Amen. Question me? Don't question me. You're questioning God. Oh, it says here, now it happened. As he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Now let me tell you what that means. Samaria was a city that was built on a mountain. Samaria means watchtower or watch mountain. So when people are praying, when they are praying, it talks about them praying what? During the watch hour, right? We're praying, we're on the watchtower because we're praying and we're looking to see what we need to pray for. So the watchtower was a place where the cities would have a high position around the gate, around the circumference of the city. And they would have people in the watchtower because the gate should be closed. They were looking to see if somebody was coming to invade their territory. So Samaria was built up on a mountain. And God was walking in the midst of this place, in the midst of the watchtower, and in the midst of Galilee. Well, Galilee is a name for chapel. So we're in the midst of people watching and praying in the chapel. So while Jesus is walking in the midst of Samaria, the watchtower, and the midst of Galilee, the chapel, the place where you go to worship, God is saying, I'm about to do something in the midst of this. While you're watching and praying, while you're about to enter in to worship, I'm about to do something in the midst of this. So don't miss it. Amen. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
So what he does, hallelujah, in the midst of it, it says, verse 12, Luke 17 and 12, it says, then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. Somebody say afar off. Somebody say, shouting distance.
Shouting distance, yeah.
They stood afar off. See, when you have a leprosy, you were on quarantine. Mm-hmm. When you have leprosy, you've already been rejected. You've already been put out. You've already been avoided. You've already been put off. You've already been condemned to die. You've already been shut out. You've already been shut down. You've already been shut up. You're wasting away. That's what the disease does. Leprosy causes your muscles to waste away. Leprosy causes paralysis. It causes your nerves to swell. It causes extra lumps and lesions on your body. It works so much so against the body that it kills you and pieces of your body begin to fall off. So you are condemned to die. And there was a group of lepers afar off. And I need you to understand that when you are afar off, you are in shouting distance. When you are afar off, you are in shouting distance. The problem is, we are too busy looking and not shouting. Y'all just missed your shouting moment.
Glory. Glory.
Have made millions of dollars with their slogan, just do it. So simple. So simple. And it's that little swoosh that stood the stand of time.
Right.
It is gone for years and
just do.
Just do
it. That's it.
Pretty and Jesus course. Started it. God started it. Just go. Just do it. What's the problem? Why is it so hard for you to follow? Why is it so hard for you to do what I said do? Go. Mm-hmm. And so he took these people that were desperate for healing, that were begging for mercy, that from a shouting distance, they were able to recognize Jesus. And when we are at the church, we are close up and we don't recognize the master. We are close up, and because I am a feminine, I have a feminine physique, and I don't preach like a man preaches, but I preach like God preaches, has me to preach, then you can't accept the message to go.
Oh my God.
You can't see the master because of the package.
Come on.
You can't
Come on
see
now.
The master
Come on now.
Because of the deliverer.
Come on now.
You can't see the master because of and too bad for you, you're going to miss this day. You're going to miss your neck. You're going to miss your healing. You're going to miss your deliverance because of the message.
Wow.
Amen.
Wow.
And it says, and so it was, as they went, they were cleansed. As they went, they were cleansed.
Come on.
Somebody say on the job training.
Yeah.
On the job training. If God said go, don't worry about all that other stuff.
Yeah.
You're about to be cleansed.
Yeah.
You're about to be healed. See, it takes a moment for the manifestation of the miracle.
Well.
It takes a moment
for
the manifestation of your miracle. Oh, that'll tweet. It takes a moment for the manifestation of your miracle.
Okay.
See, it takes you a moment to realize that a miracle is happening.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that God said that time belongs to him.
Mm-hmm.
And see, we think that one day in our time, but one day in God's time is 1,000 days.
Mm.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
And so while we're waiting for the miracle, it's already done.
Yeah.
You just can't see it.
Right.
Yeah.
It ain't manifested to you.
Yeah.
Maybe it's because you're not shouting, Jesus, Master, have mercy. Maybe it's because you didn't go that's why the manifestation ain't showing up. Come on, somebody. Maybe it's because you arguing with God, telling him, I don't want to go. Why I got to go there? They're mean to me. I don't like that. Maybe if you shut up and go. See, the enemy shut you up, shut you out, put you out, quarantined you, and you're too comfortable in the quarantine to go.
Well.
Verse 15 says,
come on.
And one. Are you that one? Are you that one? Are you that one? One. See, when the church is full, one. Are you that one? See, today I said that you need to declare it. I'm never going to be the same.
Amen.
Are you that one? Are you the other nine? And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, and only one of them got the revelation, and only one of them received the blessing, and only one of them got the full wisdom, and only one of them acknowledged the master. It said in one, when he saw that he was healed, he returned. Will you be that one that will return? Will you be that one that will return and campaign for Jesus?
Mm.
Will you be the one, in spite of the church hurt, in spite of them shutting you out, in spite of them shutting you down, spite of them making you angry, in spite of them hurting your feelings, will you be the one? Because it wasn't Jesus that quarantined them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it was Jesus that healed them.
Yeah.
See, it wasn't Jesus that diagnosed them, but it was Jesus that healed them. And it wasn't Jesus that gave them that communicable disease, but it was Jesus that healed them. It wasn't Jesus that hurt you in the church. Come on, somebody. It wasn't Jesus that hurt your feelings, that cut you, that slept with you, that tricked you, that deceived you, that betrayed you. It wasn't Jesus that did any of those things. Come on, somebody. It was not Jesus that did it to you, but why did you leave him? Will you be the one that will recognize that he healed you? Will you be the one that will recognize that he delivered you? Will you be the one that recognized that he kept you?
Yeah.
Will you be the one that knows that he called you? Will you be the one that he has more in store for you?
Yeah.
Will you be the one that knows he loves you?
Yeah.
Will you be the one that knows he sacrificed his life for you?
You better call. You better call, young lady. Come on.
That returns.
Come on. Come on. Come on.
Will you return back to God?
Yes, ma'am.
Will you return back to Jesus?
Yes, ma'am. Come on.
And with a loud voice. See, he said it with a loud voice because when he was in shouting distance, he said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy."
Yeah.
And with the same loud voice, he went back to Jesus. And he said, "Glory to God in the heights. Glory to," he bowed down and worshiped him.
Mm-hmm.
He got in a humble position before him. He was able to recognize, though you didn't shut me out, though you didn't reject me, though you didn't avoid me, though you didn't shut me up, though you weren't the one that kicked me, you weren't the one that beat me, you weren't the one that drugged me, but though you didn't do all of that, I'm returning to you with a loud voice, with a voice of triumph, and I'm going to say glory to God." He fell at his feet, at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Thank you, Jesus. And then it says, "And he was a Samaritan." He wasn't from the lineage of the blessed. He wasn't part of God's own chosen people. He was from a nation of pagans.
Mm.
He was from the watchtower, the one that was watching, looking down on the chapel, wondering why they worshiping their Jesus and why they were doing all of that. He was not a part of what and who should have been blessed.
Mm.
But with a thankful heart, with a grateful heart, with a worshiping heart, he came back in worship and said, "Thank you, Jesus." He came back and said, "Thank you, Master."
Yeah.
He said, "Thank you." Anybody got a thankful mouth?
Yeah.
Anybody
thank
got
you,
a
Lord.
Thankful
thank
heart?
You.
Anybody got a thankful
heart? Yes, Lord. Yes,
because
Lord.
Because you didn't have to be here, but you are.
Thank you, Lord.
Mm. And guess what? I'm not of a descent that's supposed to be blessed. But because of what he did on the cross.
Yes. Yes.
But because of the blood that he shed.
Yes, 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 yes.
I have an inherent right. To be healed, an inherent right to the blessings and the benefits of the kingdom. Verse 17, Luke 17 and 17, so Jesus answered and said, Jesus is answering you today.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus is talking to you today. Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? So I'm challenging you. Are you part of the nine? Are you part of the one? Yeah. I'm challenging you because Jesus is talking to you today. Before this documentary is over, God is saying to you, will you be the one or are you part of the nine? See, 10% of the church is what holds a church up. 10% of the church, the giving really comes from 10% of the church. The helping hand comes from 10% of the church. The rest of it is the nine. It is the nine that are just doing their duty. It's the nine that's going through the ritual. It's the nine that's doing it for religion and not for the relationship of Christ. Mm. See, the thing about that Samaritan, the one that turned around, the one that was grateful, the one that was thankful, he turned around and wanted to have a relationship. He turned around and did what was necessary to have a relationship with the master. He did the one thing that because God did such an immemorable, unforgettable thing, unimaginable thing, since God was the one that took me off death row, since God was the one that I didn't have to be blessed, but he blessed me. He did that one thing and he went back and said, thank you. So Jesus is challenging you. He's challenging us. He's challenging me. He's saying, are you part of the nine? Mm-hmm. Are you part of the majority that doesn't say thank you, Jesus? Are you part of the one? Verse 18 says, were there not any found who returned to give glory to God? Except this foreigner, I'm a foreigner that says thank you, Jesus. I'm a foreigner that says thank you, Lord. I'm a foreigner who God healed me spiritually, physically, mentally. God healed me. God saved me. God changed me. God rearranged things in my life. And I'm part of that one. And verse 19. He said, arise from your place of worship. Because he remembered, he got down on his face. Mm-hmm. He laid out prostrate for the master because he was so grateful. But we don't want to get dirty in church because we got our church clothes on. We don't want to sweat our makeup off because we, at church, we got to be presentable. But Jesus said, arise from your place of worship. Dry your tears. Get yourself together and go, because your faith has made you well. And he knew that when the leper, when the one left him, he knew he was going to tell of him. When the one left him, he knew that he'd never be the same. And the people around him would never be the same. He knew that he was so grateful that he would automatically testify of the miracle that manifested in his life. So I encourage you, are you going to be that one that returns to Jesus? Are you going to be the majority that goes on without saying a word? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word on today. We thank you for the power of this word. We thank you, Father God, for changing our name, changing our circumstance, changing our heart, circumcising us. We thank you, Father God, that healing is not just for the churchgoers or the ones that are considered from the Jewish descent, but Lord God, healing and deliverance is for everybody. So on today, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, Master and Savior, I want to be healed. I want to be moved from being rejected to being accepted into your kingdom. I know you came to the earth for me. You died for me. And you rose so that I can rise. Save me now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Lord, seal this word with the blood of Jesus. Lord God, let this word penetrate the hearts, minds, souls, and bodies of your people. Lord, we thank you, and we declare on today that we will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.